In exploring the social and domestic aggression that could cause a child to literally fall apart, I mounted a series of rejections. Some routine, some exceptional, some monstrous, all the while trying hard to avoid complicity in the dehumanization process Pecola was subjected to. That is, I did not want to dehumanize the characters who trashed Pecola and contributed to her collapse. One problem was centering the weight of the novel's inquiry on so delicate and vulnerable a character could smash her and lead readers into the comfort of pitying her rather than into an interrogation of themselves for the smashing. My solution? Break the narrative into parts that had to be reassembled by the reader. Seemed to me a good idea, the execution of which does not satisfy me now. Besides, it didn't work. Many readers remained touched, but not moved. Passion, instant, sweat beat, feel me, Cupid, shot me, heartbeat, racing, damp. One, I just choked on my spit. Two, auntie is a... I feel weird saying auntie sometimes because I'm talking to people that are my age. Do you know what I mean? That are my age and older. So it just seems a little... I don't know. I'm so high.
1 minute, 37 seconds later.
Lord, why am I looking at... Okay. Hello and welcome / welcome back to my channel. My name is Khadija. If you are new, feel free to take a look around, suss out the vibe. I just sit in my workspace, talk about literally whatever I want. And yes, we're a fam jam over here. So I'm still playing around with a new intro, which is why I didn't say nieces, nephews, niblings, aunties, uncles, piblings. But y'all know who you are.
We are a family like a giant tree reaching up to the stars.
It is finally here, because I asked y'all in the video vixen vid, if you haven't seen that one, please check it out. I really outdid myself with the editing on that one, I'm not gonna lie. If you remember from that video, I asked if y'all would want to see a video on Tyra, and a lot of you did, so that's what we are finally doing today. I'm gonna be splitting it though into two parts because I wanted to focus this one on just the Tyra show. The one about America's Next Top Model, which seems to have way more information and stuff about, will come later when I have the energy and brain capacity to do it. Oh my God. Are my eyes super... You can't tell. So today we're going to briefly talk about who Tyra Banks is, the Tyra show, but we're going to spend the bulk of this video talking about some of the wildest moments on the Tyra show because, my God, there were a lot. I did pick a select few though, and the moments that I have chosen will speak to my larger thesis.
Damn you, academia, I thought I escaped!
Larger thesis about empathy, particularly the kind of empathy Tyra employed when she would dress up in costumes of underprivileged folks and yeah, we'll talk about it. Oh God. Anyway, within that theme, I'm going to talk about the case for rational compassion, and I'm going to bring up a code switch episode and a book that I read for this called Against Empathy by Paul Bloom. And yeah, I'm gonna have my final thoughts as always, and I'll explain more about why I chose to read that passage from The Bluest Eye at the beginning of this video. So yeah, but that'll probably become more clear as the video goes on. You know what? Never mind. Anyway. So sit back and prepare yourself because, as the Germans say, mein Gott, this is interesting. Today's video is brought to you by HelloFresh. So HelloFresh is America's number one meal kit that makes cooking at home easy, fun, and cheap. HelloFresh offers so many different recipes to choose from every week. They also give you these cute little cards for the recipes to show you for servings of 2 to 4 or even more. I got my package earlier this week and I cooked this hamburger pasta with my little brother. You can choose from many different dietary styles, low-cal, carb smart, vegetarian, pescatarian. If you eat meat, they got stuff for you too, don't worry. Every recipe has fresh produce that comes directly from farmers. Their box that they bring all the groceries in is 100% recyclable, so they're about sustainability. Hey girl, we love to see it. And HelloFresh also cuts out meal prepping and planning, so everything takes about 30 minutes or sometimes even 20 minutes if you got the quick and easy options. Also, y'all, HelloFresh's carbon footprint is 25% less than meals made from the grocery store. That's according to the University of Michigan. Oh yeah, they got sources, okay? You know we love a source on this channel. So to get started on some delicious, easy, and sustainable meals, go to HelloFresh.com and enter code Khadija12, that's K-H-A-D-I-J-A-12, to get 12 free meals and free shipping. Y'all know free is my favorite word. Again, that's HelloFresh.com, promo code Khadija12, get 12 free meals, free shipping, so you can get started eating. Not to get started eating, but you know, like to get started on your, you know what I mean. So thank you to HelloFresh, and let's get back to the video.
I really feel crazy standing up here in my underwear. I'm used to doing this on a, you know, a Victoria's Secret runway or in a catalog, but not on the Tyra show.
So for those of you that don't know, Tyra Banks is / was an international supermodel, TV host, TV producer, judge. She's actress as well. Like, she's literally done it all. And she actually grew up in Inglewood, California. Her parents divorced when she was about 6, but Tyra says that she was a little too young for it to really have an impact on her, stating, "As far as I could see, I had it made. I stayed with mommy on the weekdays and daddy on the weekends. I had 2 birthday parties, 2 Christmases, double the presents, double the love." When Banks was in middle school, she confesses that she was a bit of a mean girl, and I am not going to hold a grown woman to the standards or how she was in middle school, because I always say you can always change your mind, and that means that you can always change as a person as well. But this is good information to have on Tyra, just for context. She does also say that when she started high school, though, she ended up being on the opposite end of the popularity spectrum because she had a growth spurt, so she was tall and lanky and had a big forehead, and kids are just mean for any reason. But it also seems that being teased like that helped Tyra understand compassion, and put a pin in that as well, because that's also going to give us some more context. In the early 90s, while Tyra was still in high school, she signed to Elite Model Management, one of the largest modeling agencies in the world, and the rest was history. Some career highlights include becoming the first Black woman on the cover of GQ in 1996, becoming the first Black woman on Sports Illustrated, the swimsuit issue, becoming the first Black woman to be featured in Victoria's Secret lingerie catalog. And it's not lost on me that Tyra is a light-skinned, green-eyed beauty. Like, we know that colorism plays a factor into all of this stuff. But nonetheless, she was still the first Black woman to do all these things. Banks also started acting in the 90s, appearing on the TV show The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air.
You ain't never gonna change! I'm getting the last word! Oh, no, you're not! Oh, yes, I am!
She also did some movies like Coyote Ugly, Love and Basketball, and of course, Life Size.
Wait a minute. You can't be.
I'm Eve, and you're my special friend.
Eve's great, no matter where she goes. Dress her up from her head to her toes. At the mall, she loves high fashion. She'll get the whole night dancing. Shine bright, shine far. Don't be shy, be a star. Where you live, where you are, be a star. Brains are so weird. How do I remember so much of that song? In 2003, Banks created, produced, and hosted the now famous America's Next Top Model. And it was originally on UPN. I don't know if any of y'all remember UPN, but 3 years later, America's Next Top Model moved to and headlined the newly founded CW. Going backwards a little bit, in 2005 is when Tyra officially got her The Tyra Banks Show. Tyra's show ran for about 5 years, from 2005 to 2010. She interviewed so many different types of guests. Beyonce was on it at one point. And there were always a lot of really interesting moments on the show. One of the most famous moments came in 2007 when tabloids photoshopped a bathing suit photo of Tyra claiming that she had gained 40 pounds. Why were we like this in the early 2000s? Like, this was my childhood growing up. Do you see how messed up that is? Damn. Anyway, Tyra came out on the show in the exact same bathing suit and told all of these tabloids to
kiss my fat ass.
And I actually remember seeing this episode when I was a kid. Yeah, I don't know. At the moment when I saw it, I thought it was pretty empowering because during it, it's not like Tyra was saying it was bad to gain weight or anything like that, but she was just like, it seemed like she was very fed up. And I think a lot of women celebrities are probably fed up in 2007 because like the tabloids are just ruthless, like wild. She ended up getting a couple of daytime Emmys, but as I said before, the show ended in 2005 after only 5 seasons. Okay, listen, y'all are not here for a biography. This is not E! True Hollywood Stories. So we're just gonna get to like the most outrageous, messy moments because that's what you don't pay for. That wasn't shade, I just, yeah. Listen, I am positive that I'm going to miss some moments because there are so many. So please comment your favorite most outrageous moments that happened on the Tyra show that you either were told about or that you watched in real time. Just comment. When I first started doing research for this video, I found a video that Jezebel did with two people talking about some outrageous moments that they remember from Tyra. So I'm gonna show you a clip here because I think it really speaks to this formula that they address.
The biggest downfall of Tyra in terms of being an interviewer is just she lacks a sort of empathy that Oprah had naturally. There is a lot of sort of ego masquerading as service.
We gotta run that back because I don't think y'all heard them.
Ego masquerading as service.
This ego masked as empathy means that Tyra basically puts on a costume or takes on the lifestyle of someone she's trying to understand. But instead of, I don't know, doing more in-depth, and I can't say journalism because I know it's a talk show, but instead of diving just a little bit deeper into that person's life or their story or speaking, she does speak to these people, but speaking even more to them, that diving deep, she ends up spending the entire episode talking about how difficult it was for her to be in this person's shoes for less than 24 hours.
All right, well, we have more of my experience living on the streets with Danielle, and it was very difficult for me to be there and for her to go back to it.
That is the stupidest thing I've ever heard.
So let's just pick some faves, shall we? The first one being when Tyra was homeless. Just as a heads up, I was not able to watch most of the episodes, almost all of the episodes, I couldn't find them on these specific topics, but this one I did find. So this will speak to the general formula that she uses, even though I explained that it's basically her just donning on the outfit, being sad, telling people, hey guys, we should be better. The rundown of this episode is that Tyra wants to expose us all to the plight of what it means to be homeless in a wealthy country like America, letting us know that any of us are literally a paycheck or a death or some inconvenience away from ending up on the street.
So the bottom line is, while there are many people trying to live the American dream, they're actually closer to living on the streets. And believe it or not, being homeless can happen to you.
So of course, she interviews a few homeless people, interviews people that have been homeless in the past about how difficult it is. There are lots of really interesting, dark and creepy shots and stats displayed on the screen and stuff to really pull you in and make you understand that this could be any of us. And she pretends to be homeless. Let's roll the clip.
I thought the best way to bring this story to all of you was to experience it myself.
I'm going on the streets, downtown LA, Skid Row. It's a little scary. I just want to try to immerse myself as much as possible into the homeless culture. I was instructed to wear very thick boots because where we're going, there's a lot of dirty needles from heroin use, and there's a possibility that a needle could go through my foot, so.
She has her makeup crew dressing her up to be homeless, goes to Skid Row alone, and meets a couple of kids playing ball next to a suspiciously looking crack pipe. Like, it's just there. I don't know. Okay, I'm not gonna say that the crew planted that crack pipe there, but I'm not saying that. Do you know what I'm saying? Allegedly. Tyra walks up to these kids, introduces herself, and you can tell the kids are looking at her like, yeah, girl, we know who you are. We're on the Tyra show. Like, what?
I stopped at two kids in the street playing ball.
Hi. My name is Tyra. Hi.
Like, they're literally like, yeah, hi, nice to meet you. What are my lines again? Allegedly. Throughout the whole episode, or majority of the episode, she's interviewing this woman named Danielle. But instead of just talking to this woman, taking her testimony about what it was like to be on the street as a woman, as a mother, Tyra decides to bring this woman back to Skid Row to help her beg for money.
And one of those tools included how to swallow my pride and beg.
Can we have some change, sir? Excuse me, sir. Can we have some change?
I feel kind of weird right now. Yeah, a little bit.
So not only is Tyra trying on homelessness for this segment, she's also making this woman who has actually gotten off the streets go back to the streets to relive some tough moments in her life. Maybe they were trauma-inducing. It seemed like it. She's doing this for views. So the Tyra show was clickbait before we had a term for it. That was all talk shows, actually. What am I saying? So Tyra and Danielle are sitting on the street begging for money, and Tyra talks about how she had to swallow her pride and beg and all of this stuff. And she's asking Danielle, do men give more or women give more? And at no point does it occur to her that people maybe might not even be giving more because there are camera crews there. Like, there's one lady that stops, and of course you have to sign a release if you're gonna be on a TV show. So most of people's faces are blurred because clearly they didn't wanna be there. Anyway, she ends up collecting like $3 and goes to a burger joint to get food, but the guy behind the till won't serve her. And she says that it's because they don't serve homeless people. But he has a blurry face as well, which leads me to believe that he didn't want to sign a release, which leads me to believe that he didn't want camera crews there, which leads me to believe that it wasn't because you were homeless. It is because you were a camera crew and he probably didn't have clearance with his boss. Also, even if that was the case, Tyra, you still look like Tyra Banks. Like, I was like, this, I was like, you just, like, I, Anyway, they walk by a garbage and Tyra's like,
while we're walking, we passed a trash bin full of food. And at that moment, I knew that if I was truly homeless, I would have eaten that food out of that bin. That would have been my lunch, maybe my dinner, maybe my breakfast too.
Tyra just discovered homelessness and poverty, and I just can't. I just can't. The entire episode was focused around how hard it was for Tyra to do what she did. She was reckoning with her guilt about being one of those people that doesn't stop for homeless people to give them change time and time again. Yeah, wow, we were literally just witnessing Tyra try to absolve herself of guilt the entire episode. Fine, that wasn't all it was about, and I get what she was trying to do, but my God. It was also just odd to watch because Danielle would be very vulnerable, talking about what she went through, and she seemed to have a really compelling story. And then Tyra would interject and bring the focus back to the segment where she was on the street and how awful this mock day on the streets of Los Angeles Skid Row was for her. She was just doing things that was taking focus away from Danielle's story and bringing it back to Tyra. And that was also happening between very troubling stats about homelessness in America, just like splashed on the screen. It was very weird. It had a tone problem. And then part of the last segment of her being on the street is her talking about how she's not actually going to spend the night there, but she wanted to see what it would feel like to sit on the ground outside for 20 minutes.
I knew I wasn't going to spend the night there, but I wanted to feel the terror of actually laying on the hard cement out in the open and exposed and calling it my bed.
I truly don't know. The rest of the episode, she ends up doing some things for a couple of people. I think three different guests. She like tries to, using this site called like Reduce My Bills or something, Lower My Bills, something like that. I don't know. You can watch the whole episode because it actually is on YouTube, but this was just basically Tyra telling us that she did this for us so that we could know what homelessness was like because she went through it. Next one, when Tyra was fat. Wow, this is, I actually couldn't find clips of this one on the internet, but there were a few articles that covered it all, to be honest. And the themes that we pointed out when we were talking about the homeless episode, that's exactly what you can find in this one. Tyra wanted to know what it would be like to be fat. So she spent 15 hours in a 350-pound fat suit doing daily activities and going on 3 blind dates. I started walking down the street, and within seconds, a trio of people looked at me, snickered, looked me right in my eye, and started pointing and laughing in my face. I had no idea it was that blatant. She then continues to go on about how she was shocked about all of this. That was her reaction, how hurt she was. People in the store weren't nice to her. Yes, next, when Tyra was a stripper. Bruh, Tyra is in blackface in this episode. I'm being rude. Like, yeah, maybe she was trying to disguise herself so people wouldn't recognize her by donning darker skin, but why is dark skin something that Tyra associates with stripping? Because there's something that doesn't sit right with me about that. And not because I think stripping is bad, but because I think Tyra thinks stripping is bad. Do you know what I'm saying? I think this is part of a different episode, but I watched an interview she did with a 16-year-old stripper that can speak to Tyra and I think a lot of our collective views when it came to women using their bodies for anything other than child rearing in the mid-2000s. In this interview, you can kind of tell that Tyra really wants this girl to tell the audience that she had a terrible childhood, that it wasn't normal, and that that's why she was stripping, and the girl wasn't giving her any of that.
When did you say, I want to be a stripper, and why? Why not? You know, what did you go through as a kid? Anything, any pain, anything? No, I mean, I had a normal childhood, you know, I grew up. Normal's relative, though. So normal to me could be different than normal to you. Right. But to me, it was normal. I went to Disneyland, you know, I went to school. It's not normal for a 16-year-old to say that she wants to be a stripper. We're doing something that's abnormal and something that we want to stop because it's not normal. It's not healthy. Well.
And Tyra just gets more and more frustrated and even mad at the girl's father for allowing this to happen. Or I shouldn't say she was mad, but just like you can tell that she doesn't approve of the way the father has chosen to raise his daughter because he didn't stop her from stripping. So that's why I think Tyra has a problem with strippers. There's this very like her being sad for them. And it's this sort of conservative, condescending way that does not lead to good journalism. And I know it's not journalism. I know this is just talk show, daytime, whatever, sensationalized, blah, 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 blah. But even just good interviewing, like if you're going to be interviewing someone, being patronizing to them, I don't know. I only took one journalism class in university, but I just think that's probably not the best way to get them to open up and talk to you and also get the best story. You know what I'm saying?
Watching the woman that was performing on stage, I felt so sad. I couldn't do it.
Next, when Tyra went to jail. Is this the last one? I was actually really upset that I couldn't find this full episode because I really wanted to watch it. But I think at this point, we all know what happens. Listen, the formula is consistent. At least, if anything, it's consistent. In an attempt to get her audience to understand what life was like for women in jail, and to foster empathy, Tyra realizes the only way she can do this yet again is by going to jail herself and sort of half-heartedly interviewing inmates with far more compelling stories than watching Tyra walk around a courtyard in slow motion. From the clips that I found, you can see that Tyra goes through receiving and releasing and tells the guard she's scared as she looks out a window, gets cavity searched, and becomes inmate Banks. Somehow she manages to switch from her hair like that to cornrows in the span of going through receiving and releasing to being an inmate. The math ain't mathin'. Again, she interviews two women who seem like they got some pretty interesting stories. I don't know how much she talked to them because I didn't get to see the full episode, but I can guess that she talked to them a bit, didn't ask them any deeper questions about their lives or whatever, and said go to thetyrashow.com for more information about this issue at the end of the episode. I'm pretty sure that's what happened. Anywho, let's get to the empathy bit. So in March of 2020, Code Switch, one of my absolute favorite podcasts, released an episode titled The Limits of Empathy. And when I was re-listening to that episode for this video, they actually talked about Tyra's fat suit at the beginning of the podcast episode. So clearly I wasn't the only one who remembered.
I am Gene Demby. And Shireen, I just want you to think all the way back to like the early to mid-aughts, like 05, 06. Well, while you were doing that and the rest of us wearing like throwback jerseys, Tyra Banks, she was wearing a fat suit.
She did. She was really leaning into that thing your parents or maybe your teacher or someone in some leadership position told you when you were a kid to convey to you the importance of empathy.
The whole focus of this episode was actually about a woman named Grace Halsell. Why is that hard to say? But she was a woman who in the 1960s took vitiligo treatment pills to darken her skin so that she could see what it was like to live as a Black person in Harlem and Mississippi in 1968. Grace's story and her book Soul Sister are honestly videos for another day. But the reason that I wanted to talk about this episode is because I think there's a case that can be made for trying to understand one, why people feel like they have to literally put themselves in someone else's shoes in order to empathize with them. And two, how useless empathy can be when it doesn't result into people taking action with that empathy. Paul Bloom's Against Empathy really explores this topic in great detail, so I would recommend y'all read it if you want to learn more about this. But let's just explain what empathy is per Bloom's definition, and I promise we will get back to Tyra. According to Bloom, empathy is the act of coming to experience the world as you believe someone else does. He notes that this shouldn't be confused with sympathy because that's more of an outside looking in with pity sort of thing, but by Bloom's definition, empathy isn't necessarily about pitying. It's about going that extra mile to truly understand what someone else is going through. Now that sounds kind of nice because we've all heard the phrase about not knowing what someone's life is like unless you've walked a mile in their shoes or something like that. People talk endlessly about how if we all had a little bit more empathy, the world would be a much better place and so on and such which. But through some interesting case studies and extensive research, Bloom calls out the limits of this empathy we're all preaching about. Particularly when empathizing with one person results in us doing more harm to a larger number of people. See, Bloom describes empathy as a spotlight that has a quote, narrow focus, one that shines most brightly on those we love and gets dim for those who are strange or different or frightening. An example he uses for this is what happened with Sandy Hook, comparing that single event and the number of children who were murdered to how many Black children are murdered in one American city, Chicago, every year. With Sandy Hook, you see that spotlight of, because this is kind of a, as he's described in the book, static noise or background of this is happening to kids in Chicago every year. People lose interest or it's more difficult for them to empathize. But if they can focus their attention on one singular event, AKA the spotlight, it's a lot easier. The other part of this empathy spotlight thing is that Bloom calls out how easy it is for us to empathize or focus our empathy, spotlight our empathy, with those that look more like us or people that we know. In saying that, I know that somebody would probably be like, oh, okay, well, then how is it that white people are the only ones that do that if you sympathize with people that look more like you? I want to bring it back to my repeated exposure thing that I talked about in the Beauties in the Eye of the Colonizer, whatever thing, because a lack of repeated exposure means you are not used to seeing particular faces of an ethnic or racial background. And as a result, it's harder, and this was in a beauty context, it's harder for you to see what you would define as different ranges of beauty within that racial or ethnic group because you're not used to seeing those types of faces. Whereas in media, white folks' faces are plastered everywhere. So even if I am not a white person, I am used to seeing white faces in varying degrees and shapes and sizes and all sorts of shapes and sizes. But like, I'm used to seeing many white faces. So I just wanted to bring that little bit of context in there as well. Cause yeah, I don't want people assuming that you only relate to people that look like you, because it can also mean you only relate to people that you're used to seeing, that you have familiarity with. And if you're used to seeing particular faces all the time, it's easier for you to empathize with those. AKA representation is, there are layers to this shit, okay? And I also think that that whole spotlight thing has a lot to do with how certain political events will have their time in the sun on the internet, and then people will just move on to the next thing and the next thing and the next thing. So how does this have to do with Miss Banks? Because what the Tyra show did with the investigative first person journalism wasn't substantial or sustainable. For an hour a week, you had a spotlight of an underprivileged or discriminated against group of people. Tyra would put herself in their positions as a way to get her audience to understand what it felt like to be that person by understanding how Tyra felt pretending to be that person. But in the long run, it was all sympathy masked as empathy. There is a place for rational compassion, as Paul Bloom talks about, because at least how I understand it, rational compassion isn't turning off your feelings on someone's plight. It's got compassion in the name. It's looking at a situation in front of you and thinking, how can I do the right thing in this moment? Or how can I do right by the most number of people in this moment? So in the book, Bloom gives an example of Zell Kravinsky, who he says gave almost all of his $41 million fortune to charity. And he talks about how for Kravinsky, it was rational. It was about the math, the numbers. So he decides to donate his kidney, and he finds out through scientific studies and stuff that only 1 in 4,000 people ever dies from kidney donation. So he says that if he didn't do it, he would have felt like his life was valued, that he valued his life 4,000 times that of a stranger. The quote is just, a valuation he finds totally unjustified. So that's him being compassionate, but it's also in a very stoic, like, well, do I think that my life is worth 4,000 times a random person? Like, nah, what rationally does that even mean? Bloom also cites this other study that talks about how when two groups of people, one of them is asked to, as best they can, objectively look at the helplessness of someone's situation, and the other group is asked to empathize with that person, the group that's asked to empathize with that person doesn't always end up doing the right thing for the most amount of people, choosing instead to spotlight the one person and their situation and help them, even if it causes harm to others in that one specific study. Tyra seemed like she wanted to bring awareness to these issues for all people dealing with them, but this spotlight was a limited focus on the few people that she actually talked to on the show. In that episode on homelessness, she helped out 3 different guests, which yes, we love to see it, but what did that do in the long run for folks on Skid Row? How did she inspire her audience to take action? Or did it even? Did they just learn some new stats about homelessness in America? Maybe from now on, they'd stop and think twice about giving homeless people change for a few months after taping? They were touched, but were they moved? So yes, now is where I fess up and explain this bluest eye quote. And I hope that it became more clear as the video went on, but the reason that I love, and it's not even a quote from the book, it's a foreword that Toni Morrison wrote about the book. But the reason that I love it so much is because just that line of they were touched, but were they moved, or they were touched, but they weren't moved. And her really not wanting the audience to get away with not doing anything to change future Pecola's circumstances in life. Instead, they just felt bad for her, and she just, her disdain for that, I really appreciated, because that's what I think a lot about with what I observed in the clips and the episodes that I watched of the Tyra show, is that yes, it is very great to bring awareness to something, to put a little knowledge kernel into someone's mind about something they might have never even known about, an issue that they didn't know anything or whatever. But beyond that, what does that do? There's a lot of conversations about this when it comes to activism and allyship and all of this sort of stuff, because to be honest, I think all emotions are valid and give you information, but some have more usefulness, I would say, at times than others. And when it comes to times of revolution, or times of even back in 2007 or whenever these episodes aired, times of trying to make people aware of the shittiness of the world around them for other people and make them aware of what they can do to help, guilt does not serve us. Guilt is a passive emotion. We need active emotions, because passive emotions have their place, but active ones get shit done. So what I think about this is, and the reason that I like this whole against empathy argument is because it's a provocative title. You hear against empathy and you're like,
what do you mean?
But the crux of the matter is that it's not about being against compassion. It's for rational compassion. It's for using not just your senses, but previous knowledge and that whole thing of like, we can all be scientists in exploration to make the best decision or decisions for the most people, or for in a sustainable way too. Emotions fluctuate so much that if you just rely on your emotions, and this is what I was talking about in my Slacktivism video about like really trying to be measured and respond versus react. If you just rely on your emotions to carry you through the whole process, they're gonna change. They'll flow down, they'll come back up, you'll be more inspired and less inspired at other times. But if you rationally think about it, you can make yourself, not make yourself do things, but in a way, yes. If it's a matter of being sustainable in your activism, let's say, in your wanting to help others, like Tyra clearly wanted to do, but missed the mark so many times, it is more valuable, I think, and this is just my thought, take it or leave it, I think it is more valuable to let the emotion ignite you, let it cause you to make the first few steps, because it's important, because that's what gets you in, and then use your facilities to decide how you want to proceed. I hope that makes sense. It seems kind of vague saying it out loud, but I just, y'all know I'm all feelings all the time, but I am also, the reason that I feel like such a contradiction so many times is because I am, but also because I am very like, okay, but what, let's just put it in simple terms. A plus B, what's up, you know? So back to Tyra. I think her brand of empathy was, it was just about the self, not just in the way of like, look at me trying to bring awareness and help these people out, or look at me suffering in this way for y'all to bring awareness to you. It also seemed very self-serving in the, I feel so guilty about this, I'm gonna do a whole show and inspire people so that I can absolve myself of the guilt that I have felt of being this kind of person to these other people. And that's why I said it was good to know the kind of middle school context of like, clearly Tyra, you know, she said she was a mean girl when she was in middle school, and then she went to high school and she was humbled, and it was good for her to experience that. And part of me thinks like, and I'm not a psychiatrist, this is armchair psychology right now, part of me wonders if that has to do with the way she has learned how to feel compassion for others, is that she has to go through it first to then realize it. And sometimes that's kind of baffling to me, but it's also not, because I get that for so many different things, so many of us, we have to go through something to actually understand it a bit better. I think for many of us that are on the fringes of society, given different parts of our identities and stuff, it's easier for us to do that because we've spent nothing but time being questioned about who we are, being made to feel like we have not as much inherent value just for existing, having to prove the value of our existence and all of that. So for a lot of us, it would make sense to just listen to a fat person talk about what it is like to be fat and what that experience is like. It would be easier for us to listen to a homeless person talk about their experience and stuff and take it at face value, take their word for it, as opposed to, because we don't have maybe as much privilege, needing it, being so separated from that ostracized group, needing to like put ourselves into the costume, AKA bringing ourselves down the ladder, so to speak, so that we can understand what it is like to be that person. Because there's no way that we could from the place of privilege that we occupy. You know, it's very interesting. It's also that whole mindset of distance can breed, not sociopathy. So much distance from a thing can I think, breed apathy. If you are not living in a country that is war-torn, don't have family there, it's much easier for you to detach because there is a physical distance from that situation and a privileged distance. If you are a light-skinned, green-eyed supermodel, yes, you are Black, you have felt discrimination, you have been one of the first people to open doors for a lot of Black girls, but you still occupy a space of privilege that is so removed from somebody that is not wealthy, somebody that is not in that type of conventionally beautiful body or have that conventionally beautiful face, someone who is darker skinned, all of these different types of intersecting identities, you're much further from that. So it makes sense that you don't necessarily, I'm not saying it's right. Don't conflate the two. I'm not saying it's right. I'm saying it makes sense that from your perspective, you have to darken your skin as a stripper or put on a fat suit or do all of this other stuff just to understand better. If you had never gone out and seek that information for yourself or wanted to learn for yourself or, you know, let me know if you think that I'm coming out of left field saying it like that, because I'm not saying that every supermodel is so, I'm just pretty and I would never understand, so I have to put on a fat suit so that I can't understand. I don't think that that's the case. I think Tyra is a product of her time. The Tyra show is definitely a product of its time. So, you know, there are many factors at play, but that's all I have. Also, listen to people tell you about their lived experiences and take them at their word. Don't think that you need to talk to somebody that's more qualified, who's more qualified than somebody that actually lived through the experience. Just a thought. But anyway, yes, I hope y'all enjoyed this. Let me know again some of your favorite or your least favorite Tyra moments, Tyra show moments, America's Next Top Model. There seems to be a lot more literature, so to speak, on that. So that will probably happen at some point this year. I'm gonna stop announcing when I'm doing videos because I change my mind so frequently and change around the schedule, poor Priscilla and Maddie. And I just feel like if I say that I'm gonna release a video in 2 weeks and I don't do it, y'all are gonna come fight me, like y'all are gonna pull up. You know what I'm saying? And I don't need that stress in my life.
I'm a lover, not a fighter.
As always, feed your plets, water your plets, and remember that you can always change your mind because you can. And I will see y'all in the next one. Bye. Why are you recording while you're high? Why are you recording while you're high? Why are you recording while you're high? Baby girl, it's gonna take way too long. Boom, 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 ba-doop-a-doop-a. Boom, 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 ba-doop-a-doop-a. Boom, 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 ba-doop-a-doo-doo. Doop-a-doop-a-doo. Doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo-doo. Ba-da-ba-ba-da-ba. Da 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 ba da ba da da do ba do do ba do ba do do ba do ba do 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 ba 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 said why are you recording while you're high ooh as the sky you're recording. While you're high, why? Oh, tell me why. Are you recording when you're high? High. Well, that wasn't that cute. That wasn't that. I thought of the note, but I didn't reach for it. You know what I'm saying? High. Are you recording while you're high, high? Why are you recording while you're high? Okay, the spirit moved me. I was possessed just then. What? Is that a record? Here we, okay. I need to actually, that was like 3 minutes long. I literally just, okay. I gotta, I hope I recorded that.